Good evening, and welcome to the October meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. The first thing I'd like to do this evening is review the minutes of our previous meeting, which was on September 15th, 1998. Are there any comments from the board?
I move that be passed as presented.
Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Motion carries. Before beginning new business this evening, I would like to take the opportunity to review correspondence received by members of the Planning Board along with our information packet this month. The first item we had was a letter from R. Russell regarding the Hemlock Hill subdivision. We also had a letter from the town attorney regarding the Hemlock Hill subdivision. On another matter, we had a letter from the town attorney regarding daycare facilities. And we also had a memo from the town manager regarding the Historic Preservation Study Committee. And the final item of information which we had was the zoning news of September 1998. Those items being covered, I'd like to begin the new business on the agenda this evening, the first of which is the Cantor Lane Morgan Lane Amendment by Shorewoods Inc., San Gammon Associates Inc., and Cantor Corporation, an amendment to a previously approved resource protection permit and public access waiver. To vary the road location and increase the amount of wetland alteration to be reviewed under section 19-8-3 resource protection permit regulations public hearing and section 19-4-2b public access waiver but notably from the pre-June 1997 zoning ordinance. So there'll be a little bit of difference on that one. Just to begin an update on the application, if the applicant could inform us of current status.
Thank you. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates, and I represent the applicant. Just to give a quick overview of the project, the proposal calls for the widening of Morgan Lane from 12-foot width to a 14-foot width with 2-foot wide grass shoulders on either side, and the revision of the turnaround to meet the town standards. At the last planning board meeting and subsequent site visit, there were three issues that we were asked to address: the turnaround, the dry hydrant, and the easement deed. The turnaround has been revised, as I mentioned, to meet the town standards, with the exception of the northerly leg has been reduced from the required 24 feet to 14 feet. We've met with the fire chief, and I believe you've got a memo in your packet indicating that he has approved this compromise with the condition that we place gravel base underneath the 10-foot grass strip, and also that he inspect the construction or inspect the turnaround during construction and make any modifications as necessary. As a result of this revision, we have increased the wetland impact from 19,508 square feet, an additional 548 square feet, for a total of 20,056 square feet. We have not yet, but we want to make sure that this is acceptable to the board before we go back to DEP. We've already been back to DEP twice, so we'd rather wait and see if this is acceptable, then go back to DEP and the Army Corps and get their approval. We have also, in addition to this, we have proposed to mitigate a total of 2,270 square feet of wetland area. The first area being in the area of the turnaround, the second area being in the area of the dry hydrant. The second item is the dry hydrant. The applicant has been unable to get the dry hydrant to work at acceptable levels, and as a result of this, the applicant is proposing to condition the approval or make a condition that the three home sites, lots 1, lots 4, and lot 5, be installed with sprinkler systems, and this has also been approved by the fire chief. And the last item is the easement deed, and I believe in your packet you have a copy of the signed pedestrian easement deed that has been submitted to the town attorney.
Very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Mitchell. On schedule for this evening, after discussion at our last meeting, was a public hearing. The public hearing is to be held under the underneath by the requirements of the resource protection permit. And since we are amending the resource protection permit, we will have scheduled a public hearing on the resource protection permit amendment for this evening. At this point in time, I would like to open the public hearing. And anyone from the audience who would like to come to the podium, identify yourselves, and share information with the board, please feel free to do so. Well, not everybody is jumping at this opportunity. Hearing no persons wanting to come forward and share information with the board, I will close the public hearing. Time reopen the public hearing, and anybody who wants to come forward to share information relevant to this application or whatever may come forward and address the board. I just ask that you come to the podium and identify yourself and where you live, and then we will be happy to listen to you. Pardon me? Yes.
I'm Richard Cohen, and I live on Hemlock Hill Road, number 5, and we're the last house on the right, and we're facing land, and we bought the house facing that land because we were under the impression that there was wetland there, and that it would remain as it is, and that is akin to forest land, wetland, and therefore give us the country feel for which we were looking in Cape Elizabeth. My question is regarding wetland. I obviously do not have anything involved regarding this particular project. However, my wife will be here later, I assume. But we were interested in knowing how development projects affect wetland or wetland areas, And we were curious to see what happened here tonight, to see, to find out whether or not there was some carryover, for example, from this project to Hemlock Hill development.
Okay.
Thank you.
Shirley. Yeah, go ahead. I guess I don't know whether it's appropriate or not to offer commentary from the board during the course of a public hearing, but I can offer a couple of things. First of all, the treatment of wetlands is provided for in our zoning ordinance, and wetlands are delineated into three different categories: critical value wetlands, normal wetlands, which we call RP2 wetlands, and floodplain or steep slope wetlands. And the zoning ordinance outlines what's permitted to do to each one of those categories of wetlands and what the procedures are in order to modify them. And in some cases, in very high value wetlands, any disturbance is outright banned. In lesser value wetlands, there are procedures whereby either certain activities are permitted or they're permitted under site plan review from the planning board. So I guess without really knowing the status of the wetland that you're thinking about, all we could really offer at this point is that how we deal with the wetland varies with the actual characteristics of the wetland as they are developed and known and presented to us. And if you follow along this evening, we're discussing here what in the ordinance is called an RP2 wetland. It is not a critical wildlife habitat, but on the other hand, it is a recognized wetland, and certain things are permitted in that wetland, subject to review of the planning board. Are there any other public comments at this time? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. And at this point, the planning board can begin evaluation and substantive discussion. If we have questions, we can then direct them to the applicant who is here. Would anyone like to open discussion on any of the relevant items covered by this application? Yes.
Well, it seems that you have responded to our concerns pretty well. There is one thing, though, that I couldn't discover on your new plan, and that is, did you anywhere on the plan note the wetland plants that you were going to plant into the mitigation area on the northern leg of the turnaround? Aren't you supposed to have somehow indicate?
Yes. The note on your plan, I believe, is indicates area to be mitigated with wetland soils and plants. We did indicate the quantity
I saw
of
that.
Plants here. That was a note that was written by the town engineer, which we responded to. It's not on your plan, but it's on the revised plan. We've located 5 arrowwood viburnums, and the quantity has been changed in the plant list.
So I should refer to the plan that I have?
No, it's not on your plan. But as a result of the comments that we received just a couple days ago from the town engineer, we have responded by adding wetland plants to this area and carried it forward on this. because the board doesn't like to have plans given to them during the meeting, I couldn't share this information with you, other than just telling you that we've done it and it's on this plan.
What are the plants that you have put on that?
Five arrowwood viburnums.
Is that all?
And arrowwood viburnums are indicated on your plan in the plant list. We've just added five to the number of quantity.
Five in that little.
Yes.
That is on the official map, of the official plan.
It's on this.
This will be filed.
Correct.
As the official.
Yes.
Yes.
A pedestrian easement, in looking at the cover plan that shows a section in between lots 4 and 5. It's a 20-foot pedestrian easement, and if I remember correctly from reading the easement language, you're supposed to be able to access that from Morgan Lane. Has any more of this been delineated on the face of the earth, or is it something to be negotiated later?
The location of the easement?
Well, there's no connection from Morgan Lane to the actual 20-foot pedestrian easement that is shown on the boundary of lots 4 and 5 that I can see.
Well, the 20-foot wide pedestrian easement goes along the lot line between lots 4 and 5 and terminates at the Morgan Lane right-of-way.
Okay.
So the intent would be for the to allow the pedestrian to circulate from where the trail is located on the Robinson land along the 20-foot wide pedestrian easement along the Morgan Lane, within the Morgan Lane right-of-way into Cantor Lane.
Okay, I guess the piece that I'm missing is the piece in between lots 4 and 5 and where it connects with Morgan Lane. There doesn't seem to be any indication on the plan where the Morgan Lane and the pedestrian easement connect.
Other than with the boundary line, the property line of lot 5. Well, David, maybe you can. I guess I don't understand the question. I mean, the easement would be described as being between lots 4 and 5 to the Morgan Lane right-of-way.
Okay, well, again, it seems, unless I'm reading the plan wrong, which I don't think I'm doing, there is an uncommon boundary, if you will, between lots 4 and 5, where there isn't a section that connects to Morgan Lane. It's actually the boundary between lot 2, 5, and 4. Unless I'm missing something that I just I'm not seeing clearly. The Morgan Lane right away seems to be delineated, but am I missing something?
No.
It terminates at the right of way, but it doesn't show the easement specifically continuing to the paved section
right.
of the road.
Right.
To the turnaround.
Could you just step right up to the podium and...
My name is David Perkins, and I'm the attorney for the applicant. The town's attorney and I have exchanged a deed, and we're going to tie it into the final plan. If there's a problem, we certainly intend it to go all the way to the public right-of-way. So if there's a piece missing there, we'll update the plan, and the deed will reflect that. The plan will get recorded, and the easement will refer back to the plan to show where the easement is. I thought we had that, but if we don't, we'll correct it.
Well, I think perhaps some of the confusion may stem from the fact that, unlike a normal right-of-way that is 30 feet wide or 40 feet wide, whatever. At this very end of Morgan Lane, the right-of-way has an irregular shape and is wider than a street and has no street in it. It has a private driveway in it, as a matter of fact. I don't think there's any intention that there should be a confusion between the pedestrian easement and where you're showing the driveway option. But at any rate, I guess in terms of any, if there is a clarification needed to
we can do that. The intent was to allow the pedestrian to circulate anywhere within that right-of-way if the board wants it more definitively defined with a 20-foot wide easement running along this boundary line, we can do that.
Okay, that brings me to my next question. Having been on the site and seen kids bicycling and people walking and that sort of thing on the, which boundary is it? The southerly boundary of lot 5 and lot 1, why was it, why did you elect to change what is presently some sort of pathway that's already there and put it into a different location?
Because the existing pathway runs approximately diagonally across the middle of lot 5.
So wouldn't it be easier to try to scoot it down the back of lot 5 than connect with the present or not?
It might, you know, topographically, no. It would be more difficult. And it would also get very close to the Vernal Pool.
Okay. I guess the other point I want to bring up is it seems to me that it's somewhat unnecessary for this pathway to exist, at least in my mind. I don't think there will be many people that are going to feel comfortable walking through this neighborhood when it's actually a neighborhood and the other three lots are built out. And from reading the package tonight, it seems that we have, there is really no obligation on the applicant's part to provide this right away. And I think out of fairness to everyone concerned, public and lot owners alike, it may make more sense not to have it and to sort of let nature take its course, because people are not going to walk across someone's backyard. They will, you know, find another way to go through the woods. And I think it's going to be an uncomfortable situation for everyone if they're expected to walk in between these two lots and then hook up to the road. Who's going to want to walk on a road? So, those are my comments.
Okay. Yes.
I have just a couple of questions. Where in the package, John, is the final illustration of the calculation between what was initially approved in terms of wetland impacts and what the amended impacts are? I don't mean the actual area calculations, but the delineation, you know, sort of shaded areas.
It was in your previous last month's package.
Will that document be part of the record in terms of filing? Or is that with the DEP as part of your permit application?
Yes, with the exception of the additional wetland impact as a result of making the change to the turnaround, we're going to revise that exhibit and submit that exhibit to DEP.
Okay. And Maureen gets a copy of that as part of the normal DEP process.
Right.
Okay. I guess I have one other question in terms of, I did catch the correspondence regarding the issue of the protest regarding having to provide a pedestrian easement. And I don't know if that's more of an issue of the political process of having to do, or the regulatory process of being required to do it versus a lack of desire to allow people to continue across the property, in the sense that I guess the Robinson property has traditionally the Robinson Estate has traditionally allowed people to walk from essentially parallel to Shore Road. But I'm not sure I agree with Mr. Parkhurst with respect to providing a pedestrian easement. I recall people who lived over in Oakhurst when that area started with a lot of infill development. They went out and cross-country skied and enjoyed that area. And then as more and more subdivisions occurred, fortunately what happened is that there were open space trails and the land trust was involved. Sometimes it's better to have at least something delineated on the face of the earth so people feel comfortable. If people aren't comfortable with walking in here, they won't do it. And if people come in here and are trespassing, then it's simply easy enough to demonstrate that they're doing that. I think that if there's an issue of abuse of the privilege of using it, I don't have any concern whatsoever with the property owners notifying the town and the police and closing that portion of the trail that isn't being used appropriately. But I recall this project was initially approved in April of 96, I believe. But I recall walking this site. I mean, it's been so long now, I'm really fuzzy on the details. Was this an amended minor subdivision application as well, Maureen? Just public access?
It was never a subdivision application. It was a family subdivision, and they just came back in to...
Oh, that's right.
Yes, you remember it now.
Okay. I just think it's important that we have a record someplace for the applicant's sake as well as ours, showing what the changes have been in the wetland alteration. And that way, if something happens on site, there's no, the record will clearly show the differences. We also had in the packet a comment from the Conservation Commission regarding a suggestion that the Planning Board, I think what the, in terms of an enforcement issue, should consider punitive measures as it may deem appropriate, including a fine. I guess I'll turn to Maureen and ask her to explain whether or not that's in the Planning Board's purview.
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is. I guess I would prefer in this case to leave that matter to the town co-enforcement office department and the town manager to deal with. I don't feel comfortable levying fines or punitive actions other than be sure that we closely scrutinize any amendment to an application.
Yes, Nancy.
I think we should have a little more discussion about do we or do we not receive an easement for the public to use. I'd like to hear what the other Planning Board members feel about that issue. And I would like to know also how your client, Mr. Perkins, is feeling these days about granting that easement. He promised it before, I guess in 1996, which was before some of our times on the Planning Board. And personally, I feel that he has a moral obligation to provide this easement, if not a legal obligation. I don't know how many members of the public were aware of that promise, but I have walked on those trails on the Robinson property, and I've never come out to Shore Road, so I don't know quite how people do that, but that is a very pleasant amenity for people here in Cape Elizabeth. And as the Conservation Committee has alluded to the Greenbelt, which is an ongoing goal to continue and to complete a Greenbelt, it just seems to me that it would be desirable for your client to withdraw his protest and graciously grant the easement.
The protest is semantics. He's provided the deed to the town's attorney. He's willing to give it. As we've already said, if there needs to be clarification on the plan to close the that Mr. Parkhurst referred to, we'll do that. So the answer to your question is, yes, he will give the easement. This process has been difficult for both sides. There's a number of things he's unhappy with that tied into his stating that part of this process he felt misused by. But let's leave that aside. He's willing to give the easement. It's already been delivered to the town's attorney, and we'll make the correction to make sure it ties into the road.
Withdraw the protest? Because, you know, that looks like a lawsuit to me.
That's fine. We'll withdraw the protest.
Thank you very much.
I guess I'll offer a sort of a subsequent impression that I had on the pedestrian easement. In larger subdivisions, quite frequently the easements will actually be developed as trails, sort of as part of the subdivision. That's not something that was ever really envisioned as part of our review of this easement, which was offered as part of the plan. But on the other hand, it's something that is sort of long-term planning on the town's part, or at least that's what it appears to be. In my interpretation, it's just something that you know you never know what's going to happen further down the road, and it could get used, but at least we have the possibility for it under this scenario. I have a question for Mr. Mitchell, a couple regarding our operations with the fire department. One of the things that was mentioned by the fire chief, or by the town engineer actually, was that we don't have a strictly conforming B40 vehicle turnaround with the fire chief. In a memo said, if I can turn the truck around there, I'd be happy with the outcome. Do you have do you envision some type of procedure whereby somehow or other you don't have to build this thing twice to make it work for the fire truck, but somehow or other before it's done, get the fire truck in there and work with the fire truck Could you tell us how that would work?
During construction, once the gravel base is in place, to coordinate with the fire chief, bring the ladder truck down to the site and have him make a number of maneuvers to make sure that he's satisfied with the turnaround. I'm very confident that this layout will work for him in his ladder truck. I say that because he has brought his ladder truck down to the existing conditions, and which is delineated on your plan by a very small dashed line, much smaller than the revised design. Although he wasn't able to make the maneuvers cleanly, he only missed by a few feet. In fact, for those of you who were on the sidewalk, saw the tire marks in this corner of the turnaround. This layout is much larger, significantly larger. The only reason we have asked for a reduction is so that it wouldn't have such an impact on the land. To answer your question, we will work with the fire chief during construction.
Okay. And what happens to the dry hydrant? Has the fire chief indicated any preference for what actually ends up happening to it, since it doesn't?
No, he didn't.
He asked for it to be removed.
No, he didn't. He said that he would be satisfied. In fact, he favored the alternative sprinkler systems in the homes.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions or comments from the board members? Yes.
I'd like to make a motion.
Oh,
appropriate.
Okay. Please do.
Findings of facts.
Be it ordered, sorry, a motion, be it ordered that based on the, okay, sorry, motion finding of facts. One, Shorewoods Incorporated, Sangamong Associates, and Cantor Corporation are requesting amendments to a previously granted resource protection permit and public access waiver to construct Morgan Lane, located off Cantor Lane, which requires review under Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit, and Section 19-4-2B, Public Access Waiver, in the pre-June 1997 zoning ordinance. Two, the application was deemed complete at the September 15th, 1998 Planning Board meeting, and a public hearing was held on October 20th, 1998. Three, the application did not construct Morgan Lane in compliance with the plan approved by the Planning Board. Should we have a date for that?
In April 1996.
In April 1996, resulting in an increase in the amount of wetland area altered, a road of sufficient width, and a turnaround for the ladder truck, and a non-functioning dry hydrant.
Insufficient turnaround. Sense the way. A road insufficient width and insufficient turnaround, right, for the ladder truck.
Okay. We'll mend as we go here.
Yeah, sure. I understand.
On the fly, real time. Four, the comprehensive plan recommends the expansion of the green belt, and an important green belt link between Fort Williams and the town center is located on the development parcels. However, the donation of the pedestrian easement is not required for resource protection permit or public access waiver and is not a factor in the Planning Board decision. Five, a permit has been issued by the DEP which needs to be revised to reflect the amount of wetland alteration proposed by the most current plan. Six, the application substantially complies with Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Permit and Section 19-4-2B, Public Access Waiver, and the pre-June 1997 zoning ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shorewoods Incorporated, Sangamong Associates Incorporated, and Cantor Corporation for amendments to the Resource Protection Permit and Public Access Waiver approvals to allow additional wetland alteration and changes that relocate Morgan Lane be approved subject to the following conditions. One, that there be no further alteration of the site nor issuance of a building permit until the DEP permit has been revised to be consistent with the plans approved by the Planning Board. And I think I'm going to add an item two, that the fire turnaround area be approved by the fire chief.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Does anyone notice that the requirement for sprinkler systems in houses to be built on lots 1, 4, and 5 is not, it's in the application at this point in time, but not actually a condition? Any board members feel that we should say something about that? It has been presented to us that houses built on those lots would have residential sprinkler
systems.
Might
be a good idea.
Is that a Planning Board condition of approval, or is that a condition for issuance of a building permit?
Yeah, I'm not sure how that should work, whether it's a condition for a building permit or a condition for an occupancy permit or where that actually needs to be put down in writing, because we do have it.
I think if we make that a condition, what I'd like to do is specifically refer to the fire chief's memo and comment.
He actually thought that was a better solution than the dry hydrant.
I don't disagree with that. I just, rather than the Planning Board acting as the trying to add language, I think. Mm-hmm. Well, the condition would be, I've lost that memo reference.
It's in the same memo. On two pages.
Okay. That's agreed.
Condition three, that the in accordance with a memo dated October 13th, 1998, from Philip D. McGoldrick, Cape Elizabeth Fire Chief, the applicant has agreed to put sprinkler systems in these homes in lieu of a dry hydrant. Of the two options, I prefer that the sprinkler system anyway. That's a direct quote from that paragraph.
I'll second as amended.
Any further discussion on the amended motion? No. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor of the amended motion indicate by raising your right hand. We have unanimous approval. Thank you very much, and good luck with your project. The next item on the agenda tonight is new business, an addition at Cookie Jar, a request by Thomas and Donna Piscopo for site plan review of an addition to the existing building located at 554 Shore Road under Section 19-9, Site Plan Review Completeness. The applicant could step to the podium and tell us what the application consists of.
My name's Tom Piscopo, and I own the Cookie Jar Bakery with my wife, Donna. And what we'd like to do is add a storage area to the back of the shop and also some refrigeration. And in doing so, that will allow me to remove my portable trailer that I have there that I store some things in right now. And just to generally clean up the outside of the bakery, and also it'll help us inside with some more room and, you know, just being able to move a little easier inside the building. So that's basically about it.
Can I make a motion?
Please do, Mr. Barker.
From the package, it seems that the submission is completely complete. So, get this part out of the way. Motion for completeness. Be it ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application of Thomas and Donna Piscopo for a site plan review of an addition to the rear of the Cookie Jar located at 554 Shore Road be deemed complete.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all those in favor of the motion indicate by raising your right hand. We have a unanimous approval of the motion for completeness. At this point in time, then, we can proceed to discussing individual items with respect to the application and begin substantive discussion. Do any members of the board have any questions about the application or Yes, Mr. Emery.
I almost felt like recusing myself because I would be prejudiced in favor of such a type of project. But I won't get into that. I grew up across the street from a bakery. Maureen, were there any discussions with the applicant regarding the extensive curb cut in front of the store? And I'm not suggesting that we revise the plan, but I recall that this came before us a couple of years ago, and there was some discussions at that point, very informal discussions about maybe looking at the curb cuts or something. I mean, this is a very common type of situation where the store is close to the street and the four parking spaces back directly on Shore Road. But I recall that at one point, if there was going to be an addition, maybe there was a, if there were any issues with respect to that type of traffic circulation, that this would be the time to raise it.
Right. I have notes from a workshop that was held November 1st, 1994, and there's nothing there about the curb cut. There were questions asked about whether or not there were any increase in employees or parking demand. The side yard setback issue was questioned, and the applicant has gone to the zoning board and gotten a reduction in their side yard setback. There was a condition on that approval that they removed the temporary shed. There was a question about underground tanks or utilities, about exterior compressors, and no concern really about the dumpsters. That's all I have for notes from that meeting.
There's comment in your application about the compressors for the cooler. Are those outside the structure?
Yes.
And are they enclosed in any way, or are they just open?
Well, they are enclosed in their own, like, aluminum, mm-hmm. like they are. But, yeah, and I'd be willing to, if the noise is going to be a factor with that, to enclose them again.
Was that discussed at the zoning board here?
Yeah.
It was?
Yeah.
And did the neighbors comment on that at a public hearing?
Yeah, a couple of the neighbors are asking me about it, and we talked about it, yeah, after the meeting. Okay.
What do those sound like? Do they sound like a compressor on a trailer truck?
Yeah, I guess.
Do you think it's that loud?
I'm not sure, to tell you the truth. I do know they're, when I drive through Dunkin' Donuts and get a coffee, they have the exact same thing in South Portland on Main Street, and it's very quiet.
Okay.
Same brand, even.
All right. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
I don't think you stated this in your application, but what are you going to do with the new space? Are you going to make another Uncle Andy's?
No. I basically just storage, you know, because the trailer is taking up, you know, some storage, and it'll just be, I'll just be able to move some things around and be able to just move more
in the kitchen.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't see any, I'm not going to increase the customer count or anything like that. And everything's basically going to stay the same, just giving the employees and I a little more room. Because I have seasonally 25 to 28 employees in there. And when it gets busy, there's most of them there at once. So.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
What about the temporary storage unit?
As soon as I get the new addition built on, I'll have that taken out.
What are you using that for now?
It's just dry storage, like coffee cups and something, things like that are wrapped that I don't have to really worry about.
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion.
Okay.
Findings of fact. Number one, Thomas and Donna Piscopo are requesting approval in addition to the rear of the cookie jar located at 554 Shore Road, which requires review under Section 19-9 site plan review. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the October 20th, 1998 planning board meeting. Number three, the parking for the project includes existing improved and unimproved parking areas which the applicant would like to improve at a future date. Number four, the application substantially complies with the requirements of Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented, the application of Thomas and Donna Piscopo for site plan review, in addition to the rear of the cookie jar located at 554 Shore Road, be granted subject to the following condition. Number one, the parking areas as depicted on the plan be paved and striped at a future date at the discretion of the applicant. when the area is paved, it should be done in accordance with the town engineer's recommendation that the parking lot be graded with an additional gravel if necessary, and then paved with a 3-inch thick pavement course.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
I note that the condition hasn't been placed on the record as to removing the temporary storage unit, but I'm satisfied that Mr. Cohen is a man of his word and that he will remove it once the structure is completed, so I don't think it's necessary.
Okay. One of the things that,
Just to answer Mr. McNichol's question, I didn't recommend it as a condition on the planning board's approval because it was made a condition on the zoning board's approval, so.
Oh, very well. Good. Thank you.
There's also a note on the plan.
Right.
Yeah. And one of the things that I wanted to just offer into the discussion was that sometimes on site plan reviews, even though it's not required, we do have either a site walk or hold a public hearing. However, we have received comment from all of the abutters within the package provided in support of the application, and the application itself is very well known and is highly detailed in its content, which has been presented to us, which is nice to see something on a small project come through with diligence and have its features all put down for us to just be able to easily understand. Any further discussion?
Yeah, let me I apologize for raising this issue. You have an agreement with the Irving Station, and there's no easement description at all. It's just customary practice that I guess they share your parking lot, or certainly you share their parking lot for maneuvering. Did the question come up at the zoning board is what would happen if the Irving Station was sold, and what would happen in terms of your ability to park and what impact that would have on your business?
No, that question wasn't raised.
I'm only raising it now because I'm not assuming that you're going to come before the board every 2 years with a revised site plan, and I think it if it's seen to be an issue, I guess I'd raise the question to Maureen, what would happen in that case?
It's an excellent question, and this situation is not, I think when the board looked at this in a workshop, and what you have before you is a presentation of the best scenario that can be worked out with an existing site. Mm-hmm. If this were presented to the board as a brand new development, you typically would require that there is a legal right to travel onto the Irving property if that's what you need to access your property. That's not being provided tonight. All we have is a affirmation by the applicant and the abutter that an existing condition mutually and agreeably exists, and they have no intention as of tonight to change it.
Okay, let me, for the record, just ask a question. The number of parking spaces that are indicated on the plan, are those numbers required by the zoning ordinance for the size of the building and type of operation? In the event that the Irving Station were sold or that agreement were to disappear, the next scenario might be that the applicant would then go back to the Zoning Board of Appeals and ask for relief or hardship based on a number of parking spaces, a lack of parking spaces, or would the business be grandfathered based on previous approvals?
In reality, what would happen is the applicant would make accommodations as he needed to, and only if he were to increase the paved area on his own site would he be sent back to a board. The ordinance, when it was changed a year ago, actually moved the authority the zoning board had over parking and placed it all with the planning board. So if he needed to provide additional parking on his site, he would probably be coming back to the planning board with that.
Additional parking from the standpoint that the spaces that are currently indicated on the plan would no longer be viable spaces.
If, for example, the Irving Station decided to put a fence up on the boundary line, the parking spaces that are on the side of the cookie jar building would no longer, you couldn't lay them out the way he's proposing to lay them out because you wouldn't be able to drive into them. You'd either have to look at some parallel parking, in which case you would lose some spaces, or you'd have to eliminate parking along the side of the building and look at creating a much larger parking lot in the rear. And if you were to take the rear area and provide it an addition, pave or gravel an additional area, that would be an expansion of a parking lot, which would trigger amendment to a site plan.
Okay, thank you. I had assumed that the rear was just about maxed out, but it isn't. Thank you. I don't have any issue with this arrangement. I mean, it's an ongoing business, and if you have an agreement with a neighbor, that's, you know, you're both operating at each other's risk, so I don't have any issue with that.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion relevant to the motion? Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor of approving the motion, raise your right hand. We have unanimous approval. Thank you very much, and good luck with your project.
Thank you very much.
Finish the scheduled agenda. Do I
make
hear a motion?
For adjournment? I'll second.
A hearty motion. All those in favor, raise your right hand. Thank you very much. Thank you. Meeting's adjourned.